Honorable Minister Shri Kapil Sibal ji, Mr. Sam Petroda, Mr. Jagmohan Raju, distinguished delegates, I am indeed honored to be here today and to be making a presentation on the curriculum framework for adult education in our country. In fact, I have been part of this process of nationwide consultation to formulate the curriculum framework, and some of us who have participated in this are also present in the audience here today. I thought it was a very rare opportunity to me personally to understand the predicaments of non-literates, school dropouts, women, and what moved me was their yearning for education, a cherished mission of our former Prime Minister, Shri Rajiv Gandhi ji. Actually, I'm glad to be sharing this panel with Mr. Sam Petroda, whose contribution to bringing literacy mission to the center stage of India's democracy during Mr. Gandhi's era is very well known. What we are, what we think and do, how we dream and grapple with our lives on a day-to-day basis and philosophize and draw meaning to our existence is inextricably shaped by literacy and education. Our modern world, about which there is a lot to be awfully proud of, mainly in the realm of ideas and celebration of the invincibility of human rights, is so much to do with literacy. The crystallization of the finest of human values and sentiments and shared wisdom and multiplicity of perspectives about our very beings has so much to do with communicating through literacy. Simply because we are literate, we are together here in this hall, transcending boundaries of language, culture, nations, to meet, empathize with, and act in solidarity for all those who have been left behind. It is so important that we have a literate nation where citizens are empowered to ask questions, seek information, it could be through the ICT, of course, take decisions, have equal access to education, health, livelihood, and all public institutions, participate in one's realities, create knowledge, and exercise agency fearlessly, and as a consequence, deepen democracy. In a way, when a third or more of our country's population is non-literate, it poses a challenge to realization of this fullest potential. Systems are to be in place to build a nation that builds citizenship, which is truly informed and literate. And in the process, the content of governance, development, and democracy is also vitalized. We know that in our country, there is a huge, but over between 1980s, late 80s, and now, we find that they can be identified and reached out to through certain clusters. In this last two decades, women have constituted themselves into self-help groups in most of the areas in the country. We have panchayat elections and 30% of it are reserved for women. And again, there is a very well-networked women sarpanches in our country. Likewise, we also have the ASHA network of health workers, again, who run into millions, and some of them are literate, but some of them are just about school dropouts. There is, again, one huge network of women and non-literates who can be reached out to. There is this Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Program, which has, again, some 3 crore workers together with their names listed on the job cards, and again, it can all be reached out to. So in a way, in our country over the last two decades, we know where they are. Earlier, two decades ago, the non-literates were hidden, invisible, and nobody even knew how to reach out to them. I think we've moved a lot in terms of coverage of the marginalized through many, many programs. All of them recognize that it's only through education that they can join the mainstream. But due to the compulsions of everyday battles of survival, they have given up on aspiring for education. Therefore, a serious program with a serious message that reaches out to them and enables them to adopt literates, about 270 million. But over between 1980s, late 80s and now, we find that they can be identified and reached out to through certain clusters. In this last two decades, women have constituted themselves into self-help groups in most of the areas in the country. We have panchayat elections, and 30% of it are reserved for women. And again, there is a very well-networked women sarpanches in our country. Likewise, we also have the ASHA network of health workers, again, who run into millions, and some of them are literate, but some of them are just about school dropouts. There is, again, one huge network of women and non-literates who can be reached out to. There is this Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Program, which has, again, some 3 crore workers together with their names listed on the job cards, and again, it can all be reached out to. So in a way, in our country over the last two decades, we know where they are. Earlier, two decades ago, the non-literates were hidden, invisible, and nobody even knew how to reach out to them. I think we've moved a lot in terms of coverage of the marginalized through many, many programs. All of them recognize that it's only through education that they can join the mainstream. But due to the compulsions of everyday battles of survival, they have given up on aspiring for education. Therefore, a serious program with a serious message that reaches out to them and enables them to adopt a new and different routine of accessing an education program of their choice will fulfill their desire for education. They have been left out because they have not had the opportunity to go to schools or have been school dropouts. The more we delay in providing them with literacy and continuing education thereafter, the dearer it gets. In a way, it is with a sense of urgency that we must accomplish the task of covering each and every one through an evolved program of education. And really, it is not just literacy as our Honorable Minister has mentioned, it has to be a program of empowerment and of continuing education of a lifelong nature. So in this sense, we must actually believe that it is possible to do so. That is the primary assumption on which we should start a program as challenging as this. It is practical, it is doable. And if this process of inclusion is based on wholehearted support of all concerned, then it can be done. And the impact is profound. The notions of solidarity, inclusion, empowerment all extend not only from the attainment of education, but also the process which enables its attainment. The principles of the curriculum framework should be fostering pedagogy of critical consciousness that leads to empowerment of the learner. Empowerment of the learner resulting in one exercising her own agency to become politically, socially, and culturally active, also self-aware, confident, and with dignity and a sense of personal well-being. These look abstract again, but then they become very concrete in the process of actually accessing the education institutions at a local level. In doing that, one has to respect the learner as a productive person, a person with dignity and a sense of well-being. In a way, the components of the curriculum must have, which UNESCO has been constantly emphasizing on, both the elements of basic literacy, secondary literacy, that is post-basic literacy, and post-literacy and continuing education. The context and principles of adult learning, as above, must inform the contents and processes of provisioning of services. The structure of the program is to be designed not as a short-term engagement, but as beginning of lifelong education, including equivalency. It is so important that there are arrangements where the adult learners can have a lateral entry into the formal system wherever and whenever possible. It cannot be a parallel system running parallelly to the existing education program, but wherever possible, the curriculum framework committee felt very strongly that there has to be a provision for lateral entry into elementary schools, secondary schools, senior colleges, and perhaps even universities. Now, these otherwise, while I say that the first step is basic literacy, the learning program should include life skill development programs, livelihood skills development programs, citizenship development programs, social and cultural learning programs, depending upon the learning needs of the adult learner communities. So in fact, it's going to be a very, very complex program, and the key to it is the local. The mantra is the community. The mantra is what happens in the village, and the adult educator at that level must be fully empowered to consult as many resources, as many material as possible to deliver the services. And in fact, this process of consultation is as important as constantly giving knowledge and information. So it has been, in a way, re-emphasizing the need for a center for adult and lifelong education as part of the education department. And I'm sure Mr. Raju will give the framework, but one is in the curriculum framework saying what must be done in these adult education centers. The basic thing is that I will skip through, but the emphasis again is on decentralization of decision making and learning from the learner and giving back to the learner. So the contribution and participation of the learner to the provisioning of services and in the process adding inputs to the education policy itself must be inbuilt into the system. And all support at the district, state, and national level has to be to this process of decentralization. It could be a program through delivered through a center, through residential camps, through other camps, and through other tools that one would use. We had also listed a strong component of training programs that is necessary, and also equivalence wherever it should have. Convergence is also a very, very important aspect with the National Rural Health Mission, with the National Rural Employment Guarantee Program, with the Panchayati Raj institutions, with the Adolescent Girl Child Empowerment Program of the Ministry of Women and Child, and also the self-help group of programs of the women. What is important is not to have an amnesia about what has been attained so far, and I think one should constantly gain inspiration from the huge large-scale movements for literacy that involve billions of volunteers in our country. To re-emphasize, the volunteers are at the core of such endeavors to reach out to the illiterate, recognize the potential for literacy. And we found in our country that through literacy program, there was poetry, literature, music, songs, which emerged in abundance. There was just creativity. And when the new learner was welcomed to the portals of literate world, not only opened a world of ideas and gave voice to their living history and emerging citizenship, but also led them beyond local and national boundaries. I can recall the small black and white storybooks of Bharat Gyan Vigyan Samiti, which have translated some of the greatest literature from around the world, are more than just literacy aids. They are portals to pluralistic ideas, values, and world citizenship. I think if there is a strong message sent by the state and the earnestness with which it gives a call to action for such fundamental and transformative empowerment is soon to follow. When utmost faith in its people and their capacities is evidenced by state commitment, local actions emerge which go beyond the expectations of the government. In fact, it has been seen time and again how a community can take ownership of the idea, spread its wings, and offer all that it has to make education happen, including breaking down many exclusionary barriers as if it was waiting for this call from its government leaders. A non-violent, silent, social transformation for citizenship and rights is launched in this process. Since several of these ideas challenge normative ways of thinking and doing things, as actually even Mr. Petroda said, one has to think out of the box, they do question the existing social and cultural hierarchies and power structures. And it seems that at this point, taking sides becomes inevitable. Strengthening of community forums which emerge serve to strengthen the collective democratic processes through local consensus building in favor of the democratization of the program and of literacy. The challenge is really in institutionalizing and consolidating this enthusiasm and providing for sturdy structures and processes to absorb the demand that there is already for education of a lifelong nature. It is in providing the continuum of education with long-term perspective of taking the learner from one stage to the next and wherever possible, giving an opportunity for a lateral entry into equivalent formal stream. Adult and lifelong continuing education has to be brought to the center stage of India's democracy. We must ensure that this is where it remains. Thank you.